So today I'll talk about the yin-yang of dyslexia and creativity, and the relationship between these two from the neuroscientific perspective. But I want to start with a story, the story of Jack Horner, a boy who struggled in school. He graduated from high school with a D-minus average, and he failed college 7 times. He had a GPA of 0.06, and he never graduated. He was severely dyslexic. How is he like now? He is one of the most influential paleontologists of all time. He's a technology advisor of Jurassic Park movies, and also he's a winner of the MacArthur Genius Award. So what does this tell us? It tells us first that he's remarkably resilient and perseverant. And also it tells us that he's probably extremely creative. It also teaches us 3 possibilities of why there might be a link between dyslexia and creativity. Number one, it could be that it's just a sheer coincidence that he was a lucky person that happened to be creative and had dyslexia. Or number two, it could be that his long repeated failure of having dyslexia has led to this ultimate success. And number three, it might be that there's a direct and causal link between dyslexia and creativity. So the first evidence that I want to present is a research study by Professor Julie Logan from the Cass Business School in London. And what she has found in her survey is that over a third of the entrepreneurs had dyslexic traits. And this is particularly striking given that the prevalence of dyslexia is about 5 to 10% in the general population. So it seems like statistically, there's a relationship between dyslexia and innovators. For example, in the example that we saw from Jack Horner, it could be Chuck Schwab, it could be Richard Branson. So there's a lot of these examples. And I want to call this the yin-yang of dyslexia. The yin-yang because the relationship between dyslexia and increased incidence of entrepreneurs is not that obvious at first sight. But also, at the same time, the relationship between dyslexia and creativity may have complementary relationships. So we'll take a look at this next. So the second evidence that we want to address is that individuals with dyslexia may have a unique brain organization. So when we typically look at damaged or dysfunctional brains, in this case, the same example here is the reading network, typically what happens is that the region surrounding it, or the opposite hemisphere, in this case it might be the right hemisphere, will show some compensation. And it might take over or rescue the function that the dysfunctional brain was carrying. So for example, a good example is the stroke patients. And also what we might see also is that the skills that these regions host in the orange region, the compensatory regions, might actually be enhanced. And we might see this case in dementia patients. We often see enhanced creativity. So we might think that in individuals with dyslexia also that there might be some kind of enhanced performance going on. And this is exactly what we see. In our study, we had individuals look at these impossible figures, and they had to judge whether they were possible and impossible figures. And while there's large individual variability, we see this strong correlation between reading abilities and visual spatial abilities. In other words, the poorer the performance in reading, or more dyslexic you were, the higher performance in visual spatial abilities. And interestingly, we saw a parallel pattern in brain activation patterns as well. So we see this yin-yang relationship between reading and visual spatial abilities in reading as well as behavior as well as brain patterns. This is also consistent with the evolutionary advantage hypothesis of dyslexia, which was proposed over 30 years ago by a neurologist called Norm Geschwind. He speculated that dyslexic individuals have remarkable abilities despite difficulties in reading. And it's also interesting that reading is such a modern, it's a critical skill in the modern society, but yet the dyslexics hadn't died out in human evolution, so there must be some evolutionary advantage of having dyslexia. So now new neuroimaging technologies, such as the one we use, will allow us to address the relationship and examine the relationship between dyslexia and creativity. So to conclude, is dyslexia a reading curse or a creative blessing? Until more research is done, we don't have an exact answer, but based on the stories of Jack Horner and others, as well as the recent neuroimaging findings, we believe that the answer is yes to both. Thank you very much.